Welcome to the Miniatures Paintbrush. Today we're going to paint up some Hexwraiths.
Alright, here's the official paint list. You can use any paints you want. I like to share what I did to get the effects that I did. These are all the ones that I use. Now, I don't stick to one brand. I kind of go everywhere with it. You can use any colors you want. It's up to you. I just want to help all that I can. So, painting tutorial part one. These are some Hexwraiths. I've been working on this for quite some time, and there have been a lot of obstacles actually to get this done. My computer, I did a lot of videos on my computer and it kind of like overloaded. I was completely full and I had no memory, so that was an issue. And life happens, so you can hobby when you can. So been doing a lot of unboxing videos to kind of get me situated where I can paint when I can, and then just develop this. So kind of stalling till this was done. First thing you saw there was hitting it with good old Steinel Res primer, and I used gray on this one. You could use black, it's up to you. I just wanted to go gray because of the bones and consideration for that. Could have gone black, but I just wanted to go for neutral. What I'm painting with now is game color bone white. That's Vallejo game color bone white that I have watered down. I'm thinking about investing into Vallejo's air line, air color. They also have model air as well that I can use. But I'm saving for that. There's a lot of things on my list to get for the studio. And I'm not lacking in paint, generally. For sure, I have a lot of paint. So, as you see, I like to paint in sub-assemblies here. That means where I have, you know, the horses on one side. I got a head over there. And I'm using a Tamiya kind of carousel for painting. It's a great little device to hold little pieces. What I'm using to hold these heads are little dowels, and I put poster tack at the end of it just so I can get them just right. Now time for the masking. I love Silly Putty to mask. I used to mask with the poster tack, but I've noticed that it's kind of difficult to get off sometimes. But I never had a problem with Silly Putty, so Silly Putty it is. So if you ever think of masking material, the first thing I ever thought of was not Silly Putty for sure. But it works out well. I mean, just watching other artists do their thing and they say to use Silly Putty, I figured I'd try it. And it really does work. Now, there's a lot of crevices in here, so you have to be careful. And this part is going to take some time, I'm not going to lie. You just want to cover all the pieces that you just painted bone white in the Silly Putty. And there it is. You see it's quite a bit. Use a couple of sculpting tools to kind of make sure that it's flush. And there it is. Like it took a while to do all five of them for certain. And what you have available there are the drapery, which I am first covering it with. It's a black, that's model color black, and just doing a base coat with that. And I mixed the black in with just a little bit of game color hexed lichen. And just so I can have that effect, I think it's three parts black, two parts lichen. I think that's where I went with that. Just to give it a base coat so it's like blackish, but still has that purple little bit of tinge to it. And that was just my base coat that I hit that with. And you know, you can start off with just a pure black if you want to. If you want that fade a little more dramatic, I kind of want everything to be that purple versus green. And then I added straight lichen. I think I went to that high contrast. I'm thinking it was like 3 to 1 black with the lichen purple and the black actually. And that little mix, what I wanted is I didn't want to hit the tops, so I wanted it to be black. I'm hitting it from the middle of the drapery straight down to the ends of the drapery. And that's where I'm getting that little bit of gradient coming from the dark plaque to the purple on the edges here, there. And what you see now is me just playing around with colors, really. At the moment, my heart wasn't set on what I was going to do. I mean, I knew I wanted that black to purple fade. And I wanted the, checked into the color wheel just to make sure what I got there. And I saw that I had, from the purple fade, that I looked at the complementary color, which was green. And I knew that I wanted the fade to go from that black to the deep, rich purple that you see there. It's almost blackish to that purple. And then I wanted to go to a really light violet or purple, which I did in later steps. But I think the way that this gradient is coming along, again, superiorly thinned down, almost to a glaze kind of consistency, and slowly building up the color. There's no room for rushing here. I mean, unless you're speed painting, and you know that's your thing. You want to speed paint. If you want to have tabletop quality, that's great. I try to go a little bit above that. You know, I really want a really nice looking army. Plus, I want to develop my painting skills. Eventually, I want to enter that crystal brush. I think if I do it right now, I'll probably get smacked down pretty hard. But there are people I look to as mentors online. Les Burley is amazing. Vince Ventruola is amazing. There are a lot of artists out there. Cujo Painting is amazing. That, you know, I gain inspiration from. And I really want to go for my dream and getting that Crystal Brush Award. And, you know, and to put it and to share it with you guys here on the channel would be amazing. Like my road onto there so you can see my development here. So what I'm hitting right now is I'm hitting actually the reins as well. I didn't know where I wanted to go with that, so I figured I'd hit it with the purple as well and see if I can have that gradient effect. Later on, I paint over that. I just wanted to have it a little more green or green flamish. Now, what I'm doing is I'm hitting just the end pieces with when I cleaned out the airbrush, like I left some of that black with the purple lichen in. I didn't clean it out all the way completely, and then I added a couple of drops of the blue violet. And what that does is it's taking the existing base colors that you have and you're adding that highlight to it, so this way it kind of like it grades into it, or it's a smoother transition, I feel, going from one color to another. So if you're airbrushing and you want that gradient, you may want to consider not cleaning out your airbrush completely and starting over with the next color. So this way, you know, it kind of transitions a little even better, in my opinion anyway. Notice that when you're working with an airbrush, you do get tip dry. I do like to clean that off here. I do have that paper on the side. I try to moisten the paper. I'm using a Badger Renegade airbrush here. You can use any airbrush, really. It's about needle sizes and stuff like that. But I do like the Badger Renegade. I have an Iowata as well. I believe it's an Eclipse. I have to check that. I have an Iowata. I do want a Harbor and Steinbeck only because it has a very, very small needle, and I'd love to play around with some fine detail using the airbrush for that purpose. I don't know. Maybe I can really get into some fine details and fine lines with it. I do want to take a class, a formal class in airbrushing, as well as an art class at the college around this area. Yeah, I'd like to go back to school. I've been in school for over 10 years, in college anyway, multiple graduations. Yay. But, I never did art. Surprisingly enough, that was never one of my majors. Speech pathology, yes. Education, yes. Leadership, yes. But never art. Surprisingly enough. Here we are, finished. There is the transition. There is the gradient. I love the way they look. They're almost glowing. I like that going from that black to that glowing. You can see it right there. Right now, just gloss varnish it. And the reason why I'm gloss varnishing, and I put it all over the miniature. I think next time I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to try to hit the bone areas, because what I wanted to do is I wanted to do an oil wash. Now, when it comes to washing, I tried the GW washes, the shades and stuff like that. I don't like the way it tones down everything. I kind of want some of that highlight left over. So what I did was, yes, let's use the preterite tense. Yes, what I did was play with oil washes. And I had a couple of oils, paints. I bought a little set for like $10. People told me that Winsor & Newton are, you know, primo. So I went out and got a 1.25 fluid ounce of Winsor & Newton oil paints. And what I do is I wait till they go on sale. I go to, I think I got these at, it was either AC Moore or Michaels. And I picked these up, Winsor & Newton oil colors. And what you want to do is you want to thin it down with mineral spirits when you want to make a wash. Only because it's odorless, although I am in my spray booth that my father-in-law and uncle-in-law and I created. I designed, they put together, they're quite the engineers. And I did have the air on, where it was venting out all any kind of fumes that comes in. You always want to wear protection, wear a mask, wear eye protection, be safe. You know, that is most important. Now, they say that's odorless and not really contaminating. So, you know, I still wanted to play it safe. So when it comes to oil washes, you take just a little bit. And you can see that I really didn't use a lot. So you really don't need those big tubes of the oil colors that you see. 1.2 fluid ounces would probably last me my entire life. Okay, I am never going to be able to, I don't think I'll be able to use all that color. I mean, unless I really started using it for terrain and I did like multiple tables, possibly like, you know, 10, 20, 4x6 foot tables, then yeah, maybe I'll go through it. But for a miniature, no, you don't really need that much. And that was what's in the cup. Was enough to give me, more than enough to give me 4 or 5. Now, when I apply this, look how it just goes straight to the recesses. In fact, it hardly even covers anything else but the recesses. And that's what I love about oil washes, is that it really just fills everything in without muddying everything up, which really is the exact effect that I want to. I want that contrast. Now, it does shade it a little bit, but if that shade is too much, once it dries, let it dry for about 24 hours or maybe even longer. That's the only downside about oil washes. They take a long time. But even when it's dry, if you want to reactivate it and play with it and take off some things off the side or anything like that, you can still use some mineral spirits. Go back in there with a cotton swab or whatever it is that you want to use and start removing areas of the highest highlights. So even if you go too dark, that's fine. You know, you could always clean it up later. And that's what's pretty cool about oil washes. One of the downsides is that it takes a long time to dry. And that's fine. With me, I'm a pretty patient guy. Like I go to work in the morning, I come back, I'll do a wash. That's great. That's enough for that that piece. And then I'll just like work on some terrain or work on another project or whatever it is that I'm working on. And then I call it a night. And then, you know, by the next day, I come back off after work or whatever, and the next night or two later, I can come back and play around with the wash some more, maybe just adjust it the way I want it to, dry it up, and continue going. So if you're in a rush, maybe oil washing isn't for you. If you're a speed painter, then probably not. I like the way it works. I like the effects that it has. I like taking my time and just really watching a miniature come to life. Now, I don't really play in any tournaments. I'm not a 40K or a Age of Sigmar player. I'm only doing it for the model and the hobby aspect of it right now. I am doing a series where I'm starting to play war games, and it's War Machine. I'm starting to get into that, which I think is pretty cool. But I would love to play Age of Sigmar one of these days. And one of these days, maybe I can get my local people in the local game area to go in just to see how the rules work and see how it plays out. And, you know, of course, my progress as a gamer is going to be posted here on the Miniatures Paintbrush, so you can catch that as well. So here I am. This is the next day. And now I'm just cleaning off any excesses that I don't want. Now what I'm using is, instead of using a standard Q-tip brand cotton swab, I'm using a makeup remover. So if you go to your, your beauty supply store, and you can pick one of these up. I think I got a set of 50 for like a buck or two. It was really cheap. It was on sale anyway. So, you know, I was like, what? Okay, so I bought four of them, four packs of 50. So I have plenty of those. Do you like makeup removers? Because it doesn't leave any hair behind, like any kind of residual. I wouldn't say hair. Kind of strands of cotton when you use Q-tips or cotton swabs like that. So there's the effect right there. I really like the way it came out. It really seems like bone there. This is the first time me using bone white, and with that contrast right there, and there they all are. I really like the bone color here. I really do like that. Now, what I did here is I painted the ribs on them, not really knowing that when I put the rider on, it's going to pretty much cover that. So, but you know what? I wanted to practice anyway, and since it's the first time me using it, I wanted to go for it. You, if you want to skip that step, you can. You don't really have to paint the ribs on the top. They will be covered by the rider itself. But I went for it, you know. Why not? Alrighty, so here you have your color here. And what you want to do is go to do the bloody parts. And what I have here is I have innards. I believe I used... Regal Red. I think that's the second one. So Regal Red and Innards. This is Minotaur Regal Red. I started with that one because that was a darker one. And I wanted to go for that brown kind of effect. And what I'm doing is along the jawline, you see like a pieces that attach to it. I think those are the muscles that attach to the lower jaw, which makes sense. If you think about it, those jaws, they open and close. You need a muscle there to do that, right? So there are patches of skin or flesh on the bottom that I hit with that Regal Red too as a base coat. And again, the bottom pieces there, that you're going to see. So, you know, go for that. Most definitely. So after using that, what I went with is the innards to give it like that from bottom layer to a lighter coat. And here are the innards. Yep. I like Minotaur brand. These bottles are huge compared to the dropper bottles you get from Vallejo or, you know, other companies, even the pots, GW pots and stuff like that. You do get more for your money when it comes to Minotaur. I think I bought the entire set of, I don't know if it was like 90 or so. I got it for like 100 and something. It wasn't expensive at all. I got it via Amazon about 2 years ago. Yeah, I've been Been buying paint for the last 3 years now, slowly but surely. Or more. Could have been 4 years. And I've been buying paint for a long, long time, amassing the collection. And I do have quite a massive collection of paint. I'm a paint fiend. Only because, again, I don't stick to one brand. I kind of like just, if I like the color, that's what I'm going to paint it. You know, and that's the way I do it. I don't really choose something very delicately. Sometimes I look at other people and what the combinations they use, and I grow like that. But basically, I'm just having some fun here. So I paint through what I want. So after innards are done and I completed everything, I went back with some humanoid flesh, again, with the Minotaur range right there. I'm using my wet palette there. I do have a video on how to use wet palettes. You can check that out. How to create wet palettes. And you can use just about anything, really. You can use sponges. Some people use sponges on the bottom. I use paper towel and parchment paper. And that works just great. And it just keeps the paint wet. Now, the one I'm using there doesn't have a cover, so I put it in a plastic bag. But at the same effect, I don't like things with high walls, and that had a low wall. I think I got it from shiitake mushrooms. So it's just a little plastic case. I stood away from styrofoam. I wanted to do plastic. So with the humanoid flesh, kind of just putting a little bit. And what I do is I put a little bit of drying retarder. I put a little bit of dry retarder in there, but I also put a little bit of flow aid in there. Just to mix it up and get it like nice into a glaze consistency. There's a glaze medium that I use from Vallejo. It's excellent. I recommend it highly. That as well, but I use Liquitex as well, Flowaid, as well as drying retarder, and I play around with different kind of mediums. Via Ventriloquia, I'm gonna start using Citadel Shades as medium as well, like mixing that in with the paint and see the effects of that, playing around with that as well. See, a thing about having all these kinds of paints is you could try all these different kind of effects. So I'm never just watching paint dry. I'm always just trying something new and developing technique, you know, trying to get better. Again, if I ever get to that crystal brush, you know, if I get a bronze, I don't know what I'd do. I'd probably cry. Yeah, I'll be a grown man crying. Definitely, without a doubt. Because I've actually been dreaming about going to, I think it was ReaperCon and getting a Sophie, but going to one of those awards. I've been a member of Cool Mini or Not for a very, very long time, since 2002, I think it was. And and I've submitted pieces in there as well. And, you know, I got torn apart, obviously, because my basing skills were, you know, terrible. Although I started learning glazing back then. So ever since then, I've always wanted to go for an award and just win a bronze, like just to have recognition of something I've done, you know, that would be awesome. And to take you with me, yeah, that would be cool, indeed, if I ever do that. But, you know, I keep praying, you know, and I keep painting. So those are the two things I do, pray and paint as much as I possibly can. My poor wife. She deals with me, you know, God bless her, really, because I'm usually down in the basement painting for hours at a time every night. And it's a holy miracle that I have not been dead because she killed me. Now, one thing about these Citadel pots, see the back there? You got to make sure they're closed. If not, they're going to dry out on you. And that I don't like about the shades that you use there. Now, I use this shade to kind of gloss it over and kind of like just blend everything in to keep it all unicoat. And that's what I use those carbonite crimson for. And now I'm going to go for the nun oil as well, just for the darkest areas. So I'm not dipping my models. I don't dip my models. I'm just trying to darken things up. And whenever I want to make like a darker shade of something, I go for the nun oil and it just darkens everything up. And that's what I'm trying to go for. It seemed like the red was a little too bright. I wanted the fleshy parts to be rotten, because this is a skeleton. It's got to be rotten. It's like zombified, you know? So you got to make sure that it's all zombied out. So that's why I went for the nun oil, just to darken it up just a little bit in variance, especially in the lowest points there. And I really do like the effect. So that's what I, one of the things I use that for as well. Again, when it comes to this stuff, you don't want to rush it. Do not rush it. Take your time. Get it done. See, the whole point of doing this is it's just building it up slowly. You know, having that control. If I just splash it on, you're not going to get any of the control. This way, put a little bit of time, you put the darkness where you want the darkness and nothing else in between. So, the highest highs, I tried to avoid hitting the nun oil on because I want to kind of like dark. Again, the effect is pretty cool. I started seeing brush strokes and I didn't want to see the brush strokes. So that's why, again, went to that nun oil. I got this paintbrush at the Complete Strategist. No, they do not fund me in any way. In fact, I don't get any funding for any of my content, and I kind of want to keep it that way. I don't have a Patreon, and I'm not intending to monetize any of this. This is just me trying to do some hobbies and sharing it with you because I think it's cool. So I don't anticipate doing any of that stuff in the future anytime soon. So as far as I can help it, it'll be ad-free for as long as I possibly can. Anywho, getting back to this really cool MIDI. This is the second, I would say. I mean, I've painted some little goblins in 2002 with Citadel models. That was Warhammer Fantasy back then. But this is actually, you know, I'm kind of new into the phrase of using Age of Sigmar models and just using Games Workshop stuff in general. And I got to say, man, I love the detail. I really do. I think it's awesome. All right, here we go for Clear Red from Tamiya. Now, this is acrylic paint, but it's not really, I mean, I clean my brushes out with alcohol and I use separate brushes just to use this. I do not use my fine detail brushes with Tamiya. Sure, some people do, but not me. I use the synthetic stuff. And these brushes are old, ancient. So I am going to use that. And what this does, it gives it that little shine to it. Makes it kind of like bloody, I guess. So it looks like some of these sores are weeping and it doesn't look so matte. And when it comes to like bloody things, I kind of want it to shine just a little bit. Again, I don't slop it on. I kind of just put it in different areas where I just want to shine up. Some people don't like that, so you can skip this step if you want to. It's all up to taste and what you want to do. I kind of wanted it to be a little glossy, so I went for it. And there it is, all shined up. I think it's pretty cool. Yeah, it kind of gives it that shiny effect that, yeah, this is like rotted flesh, and yeah, it still is flesh, but it hasn't dried out yet completely. Alrighty. Now what I'm going to do is using game color of Scorpina Green. I'm highlighting the back. I base coated it in flat green. And I'm highlighting it with a Scorpina Green on the bottom. And that's just like the flames that come from the bottom. And I wanted that gradient. And that's the same gradient that I used for my Spirit Host. And if you haven't seen that video, I have a video on how I did that one as well. I'm trying to get better with these tutorials as far as camera angle and having all the stuff in front of you. With the Spirit Host, I think it was off to the side or something. I'm just playing around with the camera. Again, flat green for the base. This model color, and then the Scorpina Green for the highlight. And this time I'm just going to paint it. You see on my wet palette there, flat green. And this is the reins that I went over before. I kind of wanted to do the flames in a flat green and just bring that up as well, so it can match the bottom. I'm trying to do a triangle where it's the bottom two pieces and a piece on the top, so the eyes can have something to look at. And I want to draw your eyes to the bottom, I want to draw your eyes to the top, and I want you to see the gradient in between with the purple and the high contrast. So there it is, a base coat of model color flat green. And I think it kind of came out pretty cool. If you're going to do some airbrushing, that means some masking is involved. That means I'm busting out the silly putty. And you can see the end effect over here where I kind of just did the tips. You know, again, you have that color on there. You have it on the bottom. I'm trying to go for that triangular effect for the eyes to kind of look around the model. And if, you know, your eyes kind of look around the model, it kind of goes from the top to the sides and where you want to draw the eyes to. And that's exactly where I want to draw the eyes to. So I went the extra step and not glazed it. I'm sure I could have glazed it, but I don't know. I'm still working on my glazing techniques. I'm nowhere near Ventuela's when it comes to that. So hey, when I can, airbrush it is. Glazing comes next. I do have that those Blood Bowl models, those dwarves, and they have that armor. And I'm going to try, definitely with the non-metallic metal, you have to, you know how to glaze. So that's going to be my glazing tutorial there. glazing takes time, so it's just going to take time. So here I am putting some silly poly. You can see I'm using the back of the brush. If you don't have any tools, some sculpting tools to help you, you can use the back of your brush just to shift it around. And silly putty is cool like that. It doesn't really stick to the paint, so you know, you don't have any of the paint lifting, which is awesome. And you want to make sure you have complete coverage of the background. You don't want any kind of overspray on anything, so be careful with that. Now it's time for the airbrushing and show you what I did. So it's at the lowest setting and I'm just trying to dot the ends of it. See how it's just dotting the ends of it? There you go. Just a little bit of dot at the end of it. Just going along a little bit here, a little bit there. Don't go crazy with this step here. Okay. You just kind of want to hit the tips. Okay. And, really, really be mindful of where you're aiming your airbrush. So this way you're not getting any overspray on your previous paint jobs, which would stink. Always press, and I always kind of spray on the side on the paint table before I start spraying directly to the model. And now all I'm doing is it'll lighten up the areas I really want that brightness to. And you see there? There's the transition I was looking for. All right, well, now that we're done with the horses, well, for the most part anyway, in the middle of this project, I had ordered, I don't know, was it 13 metal color, acrylic metal color from Vallejo, all because I heard they were the best acrylic metallics you can buy. And I had to wait for them to come in. So I didn't do the metallics on the, well, I did a metallic on some of the blades and stuff like that, but I didn't want to finish it off, you know, until I got the model colors back. So here what I am doing is I'm going to go for that same kind of fade that I did with the Hexwraiths, with the, with the horses. And I'm going for the same pattern. So I did it in black. This time I didn't do the purple black in the beginning. I started with straight black, and that's model color black. And then I went and emptied the airbrush, but I didn't empty it fully. And then I put in the lichen purple, the hex lichen. I'm sorry, that purple color from Game Color. And that was going to be my mid-tone. Which I only hit not above the waist, from the waist below. So it has that black going into that gradient, into that hitching purple. Now, when I do these, again, the sub-assemblies, but I do them in assembly line, where since I have a unit of five, why not? Don't clean out your airbrush. You still have the paint in there. Go over all the pieces you possibly can in one shot. Notice that I did these corks, and the corks always kept on falling on me. Now, some people put a quarter on the bottom. That's great. But I had extra pieces of cardboard, which I use for my terrain projects anyway. I cut them off, and it really makes them super steady. Not that they're impossible to take over, but still super steady. And what I did was is that I took the glue gun. That's what it is. I took the glue gun and I glued it down there. I love using glue guns. It's pretty awesome to glue things down and semi-permanently. And they dry so quickly. You just have to be careful and quick about it. Okay, so after I got the purple base, I went a little lighter by adding blue-violet to the mix and hitting that blue-violet on the very, very bottoms. And again, this is a mix until I just completely clear out the airbrush and I hit it with straight blue-violet to have that really, really strong contrast at the end. In retrospect, I might want to have hit the horses the same way, although I'm very satisfied the way they came out. I don't think they did anything wrong there. I just feel like the riders had a little more contrast. Maybe it's actually better that way because the riders are the highlights of the piece. So having their contrast be that much more dramatic would make sense. Again, this is all artistic preference. It's up to you what you want to do. These are your models. And you can do with them as you wish. There I am hitting it with, I think this is a pure blue-violet. And you see how that contrast is really bright. It's almost that glowing effect. I really like the way it came out there. Remember, Silly Putty, you really, really do have to really intentionally mask and make sure that you get all the way around so you don't get that overspray. I really think that it came out fantastic here, guys. Look at this. I like the way that it's really glowing. And the color combination is pretty cool, I gotta say. Again, you can paint your army any way you want, really. If you follow that gradient, the pattern that I'm using, but using different colors, it'll definitely work for you. I mean, it's just use the colors that you're happy with. Now, since I have a lot of pieces to this army, and for me, a lot of pieces is I think it's all the Star Collecting boxes and a couple of HQ units. And for me, that's a lot of pieces. Might not be for some people, but for me, definitely. And it might take me a couple of years to actually get them all done. But that's okay. I mean, that's cool. All right, so now, hitting bone white. What I did with this model here, I hit it with brown first, thinking maybe brown would help, but to help the bone color come out more bony, I guess. I was mistaken. What it did was is add more steps. So I don't recommend you painting brown on top of your skeleton before putting on your bone white. All right, so now this kind of, for this step, I wanted to show the differences between the bones of the horses and the bones of the humans. So instead of using the oil washes, which I do love, I hit the model with Agrax Earthshade to kind of tone everything down. And then I was going to highlight everything up as well. And I did highlight it up with some bone white. All right. Well, time to get the flames on the bottom of these little cauldrons and outward flamey bits. So that means some more masking. You gotta love this masking. I did some edge highlighting as well. See the edge highlighting right there? Again, starting with that flat green and as a base, and then hitting it with Scorpina Green for the highlights. So, and that's pretty much the theme with all the flames. All the flames have the same kind of theme where, you know, I'm going to hit it with that flat green. I was going to use Goblin Green, but, you know, the more I try to use Goblin Green, the less I kind of wanted to use Goblin Green, only because that flat green was a little more darker and it had that contrast. Now, if you look at the cape along the side, you're going to see some edge highlighting there. I do have an edge highlighting video that you can check out. And that'll help you get those edge highlights there. I didn't want to kind of repeat the process as much. Kind of just show you that I did some edge highlighting there. But here are the flames, and hopefully I can get that back into the camera. There it is. Come on, Rob. Get the miniature back in the camera. Painting with a camera is interesting for sure. Definitely challenging. I can't say that it's definitely easy. You kind of get used to it, but you got a big old camera in your face. And I kind of like to get close to the miniatures when I'm painting, especially when I'm doing small areas. So, I mean, that creates a challenge. But the reward is that I get to share this with you guys. So, I mean, it's so worth it. So you just repeat the process. Your base color, it doesn't have to be flat green. I like the flat green because I like it so dark. You can use some other base color. I didn't want it to be so dark that it's unrecognizable as green, but at the same time, I wanted it to be, I didn't want it to stand out because it was a base. And if you're going to do edge highlighting, you kind of want to accentuate that. I really had a lot of fun. I mean, being that it was several weeks in the making and there was a lot of challenges when it comes to technology, when it comes to time, when it comes to so many other things that are going on, to get to work on it is awesome. Now here I'm using a Games Workshop brush. This brush I bought way back in 2002. It's the old style brushes that I never used. I was afraid because I stunk at painting and I kept on ruining brushes. And at the time I invested quite a bit in these brushes. I brought an entire set. So I spent, I don't know, it was at least 100 or 200. I don't know. It was a lot of money, back then. And, I didn't want to mess them up. Now, finally, 2017, 15 years later, I've gotten the, gonads to brush with them. I know not to get the paint in the ferrule. That's where the metal meets the brush. Do not get paint there. If you see paint creeping anywhere near there, wash out your brush. Yeah, get it out of there. Do not let it dry in there. Whatever you do, do not let it dry in there. So be careful with that. If you can do that, you maintain your brush. That clean the brush thoroughly and you put it into some shaping agent. I do have a brush soap that I use. And it shapes the brush to a point. And then, you know, make sure you dry the brush as well. So that's really, really important that you do to maintain your brushes. But I'm going to do a video on brush care and what I do to maintain my brushes. And that's coming up as well. It was a lot of fun doing these. I did paint the sticks. Nothing special. I did try to use a muddy brown. And then I played around with bark color and then a humanoid flesh to kind of have that contrast. I didn't like the way the edge highlighting came out on the wood. So, you know, I glazed it over. I mean, I washed it with Agrax Earth Shade. So I have a lot of tonal variation with that. And the tonals are subtle. But working with wood is something that I need to work with some more to really get that transition down. I was going to do a gradient where it goes from one to another in the wood. But I decided against that. I wanted the highlight to really, really be these flames and not anything else. So I kind of want to tone it down when it comes to colors, especially with the wood and everything else. So I didn't really go crazy with that. I really did enjoy painting this and making these hex wraiths come to life. I think it's an amazing process. and I'm blessed to do it. Alrighty, now getting back to those cauldrons. So, that's a bit of masking. And I didn't mask it all the way because I wanted to kind of have some overspray, some object source lighting, a little bit, just a little bit, you know. So here we are, masked up, and right now, am I using my Iwata? No, still using the Badger. So what I'm doing is, again, base coating in that flat green really quickly. And then I hit the edges with Scorpino Green. Again, the same effect. You're going to see me do the same effect throughout because I wanted to have some consistency throughout the models. The only difference that I did have between this model and the Spirit Host is edge highlighting. And that was a first for me. I never edge highlighted before. I always thought I might mess it up. But using the side of the brushes is key when it comes to that. So hitting it with Scorpino Green, I wanted the brightest parts to be the center where the heat is coming from. You can do the same effects with the oranges, the yellows, to the whites, to the reds, and make flame. But since this is a spiritual kind of flame, I wanted to go with my the colors that I use for my onions, which a lot of people call my my spirit host. And even I call my spirit host because I have a sense of humor. Some people don't. I do. I don't mind. If you can't laugh at yourself, then yeah, you're too uptight, in my opinion. Have some fun. You get this one chance of this life, you know? Really? Make the most of it. Have some fun. You know? And I love it. I love in life. Hey, putting some light on this subject. One would think with 1600 watts of light at your disposal at any given moment, you can use some of that light, right? We're only talking about 1600. I got 2400. That's a lot of light. Thank goodness they're not all on, because then I'd just like bleach out the picture. Alrighty, so now I've done the flames and I'm taking some of this stuff off, and you can see the transition, the glowing of the spiritual flames coming from the cauldrons. I think it's really, really cool. Here's a more dramatic effect there. You can really see it there. That light does wash out a little bit of the dramatic, but you'll see it later how dramatic the transition is from that light to the darker. Again, you can do that with flames, but again, you have to do, you can go really hot and go from a white to a yellow, to an orange, mostly orange, and then just like tips of red. Because if you look at the flame, it's mostly orange, you know. Sometimes it's blue, but I don't know if you want to go for that effect. Blue flames look cool. Hey, maybe one of these days I'll do some blue flames. Yeah, now there's some inspiration right there. I should work on my Malifaux stuff. Anywho, that's for another tutorial. Once I finish one box set, then I'll go into another one. I did order the 2017 Troll Bloods Army box, so that's going to be fun to build and paint and do a tutorial on. A lot of my stuff are hordes. I have a lot of hordes model that I painted up, and those are the ones that I started with. And that's when I got into Games Workshop and tried their stuff. So here I'm just adding some details with some more edge highlighting on the face. Certain areas and subassemblies I didn't put together, only because they came in later, so I'm painting it later. There's some just touching up with some edge highlighting. And I did the edge highlighting already, but I just noticed some places. And sometimes when you're painting, you're not as methodical to catch every little detail the first time you go. Sometimes you go back and you kind of look at it and look at it and look at it. What I do with my models, and I think everyone in the household thinks I'm a little bit nuts with this, I carry my model with me. So I wake up in the morning, I go to the restroom, I look at my model. And in the mornings, for some reason, when I'm sitting on the throne, on my king of the castle, and I'm looking at my model saying, what did I miss? What can I do? I kind of plan out my evening that way. Start off my day with a model and then plan out my evening and then get really excited about modeling when I get home. And so, yeah, that's what I do. Now I'm hitting things with bone white. Again, using the Citadel shades to do your shadows, it really tones down everything. And I'm not crazy the way it looks. So I go back and do some highlightings. Never let your shade be your last coat. Nope. Nope. If you really wanted to put some oomph, and it only takes about 5 minutes, really. If you want to put some oomph to your model, highlight. You know, just a little highlight here and there goes a very, very long way. And here I am highlighting the hands because they look like a muddy mess. And I kind of want that transition. So again, if you go to highlight, you do an edge highlight, and use the edge of the brush and not the tip. Now time for the assemblies. Again, I hit it with the same technique. Now I'm doing the side curtains of his face, which I'm using. And finally, the metal color acrylics from Vallejo came in. Again, highly touted as the best metallics you can get with acrylic color. So I went ahead and got the set. And what I'm doing is I'm using glaze medium with this. And the reason why I'm glazing metallic, I'm almost doing a non-metallic metal effect with metallics. In other words, what I'm doing is I'm creating a gradient with it. I'm going more metallic on the bottom and I'm fading it from the green, the Scorpina green, into the metal, into like a really deep, deep metal. So I was working there with some magnesium. That's the color I used for that there. And the lowest lows, you want to hit it with jet exhaust. And that's what I use that, magnesium. And then for a highlight, I used beryllium because I didn't want it to be too contrasty. I don't want it to look like a chrome. And if you look at metal pieces, they're not chrome. They're not reflective like mirrors. And even when they are, it's almost like a whitish going to an extreme highlight. So here I am, just putting the head on, and you can see it as I'm going to the tip. It gets a little bit darker or more pronounced when it comes to it. So it's going from light to the more opaque on the bottom. And that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to create a gradient when it comes to the metallics. Now, I don't dare do that with any other metallic paint except for this one, only because if you glaze down metallics, they separate really easily, so you'll get just a whole bunch of metal flakes. Now, the difference between those metallics and these metallics is that I put glaze medium in this. I thinned it down. I mean, way, way down to a liquid consistency, and I could still use them. And they don't flake up on me. They keep their consistency. The pigments of those flakes are so well grounded up that it's so much easier to work with. And you're not like glopping stuff on because you want to get coverage either. You're just glazing it on, building it up, and then you get the coverage you need and the control that you want. So I definitely give the metal color, and they're meant for airbrushes. That's why the pigments are so fine. I give them a thumbs way up. I also like to comment that if you open up these bottles, I'm going to open up one right now. I'm looking up with one, and they have this like little spigot in the middle. And like a drip rails on the inside. It's kind of hard to explain, but it's pretty cool. It's definitely not your standard dropper bottle. All right, so looking at the metallics that I used there to begin with, I did not like the way it looked. Again, those were thinned down, so it almost looks gray and not metallic-y at all. And I was using Vallejo's model color. I think it was a silver. Steel. And I didn't like the way it came out. So I went back and I painted over using jet exhaust. And that's what I started with there. And I did the helmets. I used the P3 coal steel. That's what it was. I wasn't a fan of the coal steel. That's what you get with the coal steel right there. It looks gray. Nothing crazy. Now here's the comparison with the metal color for the airbrush. And it's much deeper. It's not just gray. you actually see from one to another. One's just gray and the other one is really, really steel-like. So that's the one I like to go for. And there's the difference. And look at the contrast in the nose and everything. All right, let's get back to the writer. And getting back to the writer, we're going to hit down. I never did the actual seat. And once I did the saddle there, I wanted to do that in steel. I know it's a hard ride, but, you know, he has a bony butt, right? So no cushion at all. He'll be saddle sore in the morning. Rattle his bones. All right, enough puns. Enough puns. Or is there? Anyway, I kept it simple. I did some highlights. I went to Jeddah's Exhaust and I did some highlights with Derillium. And once I complete the saddle, horses were completed. So let me show you a picture of the horses completed and celebrate that once before I cover it up with the riders. And there they are, the horses as a standalone. If you wanted to do a standalone, that's the way you paint them. That's the way I would paint them anyway. But now to cover them up with the riders. Again, that step you could definitely, I only painted that top part there only because I wanted the practice. So what I did was I clipped off the little nub that goes into the hole only because I didn't like the way that it was fitting. I started scratching the paint job for the horse. I was trying to get him in there. Forget that. So what I use here is Tamiya's ultra thin cement. Which sort of melts the model, and then I join the two pieces snugly together. All right, you kind of want to use gloves on this one. You don't want to use the hand. Rob, don't use the hand. You kind of don't want to use the hand there, only because you might peel off some of that paint, and you don't want to do that. So, Rob, stop using your hand. All right. I'm trying to take my own advice. I should have had gloves on both hands, honestly. So, if you're doing it yourself, try the gloves on both hands. So this way, because I did actually peel off some of the edge highlighting of some of them, and I had to go back and redo that. But here they are mounted. Yes. Very happy the way they came out there. And here's a picture of them mounted all together. Oh, yeah. That's looking sweet. Woo! I'm loving that. But we're not done. We're coming back and you're going to do the chains now. Again, using that metal color, jet exhaust. And this is just pure jet exhaust. I didn't really do too many highlights with this one. I was going for just playing around with the colors. And this is the first time I ever used the model color acrylics, metal color acrylics from Vallejo. So I'm just kind of playing around with it. And you see my results of playing around with it. And I'll get better with it. So, you know, later pieces will look even better than these. And that's the thing. A viewer had asked me, what's your favorite model? And my favorite model is always the current one that I'm doing. And the reason why it's the current one I'm doing is because I'm getting better every time. I keep on playing with different techniques. I keep on working on different things. And that's my entire goal, just to keep getting better, not to sink into, oh, these are good enough. No, it's not good enough. I'm not going to get better if they're just good enough. I want to push myself. So I say, oh, I want to play with this. Or, oh, I saw this on a YouTube channel. I want to try this and I want to try that. And I want to try what this does. And I play around. I do. And I think it's a lot of fun because it's all about the discovery. It's all about the adventure. And I'll say it a billion times and I'll say it a billion times more. Painting for me is an adventure. I keep on trying new techniques and trying new things and trying to better myself. All right. Now I'm doing the cauldron right down there. I'm doing the finishing up bits there. And time for a black wash, Winsor & Newton oil color. And what I'm doing the black wash is in the darkest recesses. And absolute darkest recesses, and I want to kind of control it. So here I am, just getting the bottom of the blade. I'm hitting that in the bottom of the blade. I kind of want to darken that up just a bit. Muddy up the bottom of the blade. And then on the top of the blade, I'm going to hit it with some some more model color just for some highlights. And this way it'd be darker in the bottom, lighter on the top. And that's how I hit it. I try to think about where the light is coming from. It's probably coming from above. So I kind of put the highlights on the top and to contrast that with the lighter colors on top and darker colors on the bottom. Okay. So here I am just adding some finishing touches, playing around with some highlights for the metallics, for the metals there. And here's the fun part. Because you really, I mean, at this point, it's like, oh my goodness, am I going to wreck it? And they're like, no, I'm fine. It's fine. You don't have to worry. You're having fun. So yeah, so when I started this video, I mean, it is over an hour long, this video. But it's 5 hours of recording, the very least, that I took. And when I did one model, I kind of like did the other ones off screen. So it took like 25 hours, I think, of modeling time to get this done, at least. 25 to 30 hours. It took me to get it. And, you know, an hour a night here and there, 2 hours, weekends, 8 hours, maybe 6 hours. I don't know if I can. So here I am using this lighter. I think it's Duralium. Yep, definitely Duralium. I had to open the package right now just to check. I have to open the bottle right now just to check it. So here I am just taking it straight out the bottle. And I wanted to test what that's like. So I didn't want to do a dry brush. I wanted to do a moist brush. That's what I call it. It's between dry brush and wet brushing. And I just wanted to get the tops of the chains as a highlight. So you can call it a dry brush, but it is definitely not a dry brush. It's a moist brush. Because I'm not really wiping it down on anything, but I'm getting it wet enough. There it is. Just wiping a little bit more, and just going over the top. And I like the coverage. I like, especially since I'm doing a highlight, I like the coverage. And it does have that dramatic effect. And you only want the tips on these. So this way you have the dark shadows in the background, and then the tips of it really, really bright. And this is actually the last part that I do for the model. So we're getting to the home stretch. We're just about done. All I'm doing is little highlights here and there. I think I just did the highlight, and I did the same highlight for carapace of the head. And I did it to all of them. And I mean, this model is absolutely fabulous to work on. Absolutely amazing to work on, and a pleasure to get done. Now, this is a part one to a two-part series. As far as painting the miniature, after this step, I'm just done. You know, this is the last paint that I'm using, Duralium here. And then the miniature is completely done. And then I have to worry about the base. Now, when it comes to the base, I just ordered some rolling pins. Well, not just order. I ordered rolling pins about a month ago, and I've been waiting for them to come in. And it's been over a month, and I ordered from, it's a company in Spain. It's called Green Stuff World. And I know Spanish, so I asked them, it's been a month, where's my stuff? And they said they sent it like a week after I ordered it, but you know, by the time it actually got here, and then USPS and customs and all that good stuff, when it finally arrived, it was about a month later, and I've been waiting for that to do the bases on these. So I've been waiting for that. So while I was waiting for that, I started working on another project. It's the Lonely Hearts Cottage, which I'm going to post up as well in another tutorial for terrain, which I'm building for my war games. So I did an entire other build by the time this came in, and I kind of downloaded both to my computer. So having over 10 hours of film, at least 10 hours of film, kind of like filled up my laptop. So I ordered a 3 terabyte external drive, which is coming soon. So this way I won't have that issue again where my computer crashes on me every 5 seconds saying, oh, memory's full. Your hard drive's full. Too much. Yeah. Basically asking for me for mercy and me kind of freaking out and kind of figuring out the problem calmly. Was challenging, but I got it. And finally I got this, and then that's awesome. So I need to publish this one, and I'm going to publish the Lonely Hearts Tavern, and then I'm going to do part two of this, which is working with green stuff, working with the bases, and rolling pins and doing the bases in this again, theming it after the other one. So it has to match the spirit host in some way, at least, it's spirit cousins. Another pun, I know. So what I'm going to do now is show you the finished product, and I'm really happy you joined for this part one. All right, time for the outro. Wraps it up for the Hexwraiths. You can base it to match any army that you'd like, as far as basing is concerned. I'm playing around with some green stuff. I do have to say this was a really exciting paint, and I'm happy I can share it with you. Speaking of sharing, like, comment down below if you have any questions, please ask, and share with others. Press that like button, that always helps too. All right, well, I'll catch you next time on the Miniatures Paintbrush.